any other variant. We're conducting studies to better understand the aspects of Omicron. They said that this may be due to increasing overall numbers of people becoming infected. That is in relation to the number of the data suggesting that there are many people being hospitalized in South Africa, and they said that it is rather not because of specific infection with Omicron. So they are urging nations not to close their borders and take precaution as much as possible. We have a story of FKF Mwendwa, who is still in police custody for another night. The beleaguered FKF President Nick Mwendwa will Monday spend another night, that was yesterday, spent another night police custody, in police custody following his arrest on Friday last week. A Nairobi magistrate on Monday directed that Mwendwa be held for a day pending her ruling on whether he should take plea for to charges of corruption. That is as far as that is concerned. And 10 Rockers clubs, eateries in Kisumu must soundproof. So, visiting Kisumu, yeah, be sure to take your earplugs unless you love that ear-splitting music and don't like a good night's sleep. So, most of them, according to the city manager, Abala Wanga, said that bar owners deliberated and over the notice saying that they must adhere to that rule within 6 months or else their licenses will be revoked. Okay, moving quickly on to that story of the terrorists who say that they tell how they escaped from committee. It's a full page read there, but you can take a look, but just a snippet. They said that the prison break started with a smile, a couple of jokes, and a bundle of money, the sum yet to be known. And that's how it led to their daring escape from the prison. And finally, it's hell in Saudi Arabia. Survivors tell MPs they say that their employers overwork them, and sometimes with no pay, and sometimes turn them into sex slaves. So they were responding to the National Assembly Labor Committee there. And another sad story again, a veteran journalist was killed using laptop cable. An autopsy conducted on the body of veteran journalist Gatonye Gathura shows that he died from trauma from the back of the head and strangulation. The journalist, whose body was found dumped along the Naivasha Maimahu Road last month, died of lack of air to his brain, which was caused by strangulation using a laptop wire. That's according to government pathologist Dr. Titus Ngulungu, who addressed the media in Naivasha after that autopsy. And just to tell you that later on in the next hour, we'll be having that discussion with the CS for Water, Sanitation and Irrigation, Cecily Kariuki, just telling us how her ministry has been performing to this end, having in mind that her ministry is actually in the center of all the Big Four agenda. That is coming up in the next hour. Jen.
Let me now run you through the front page of the Daily Nation. Some of those stories have also been featured here, but just to add on that particular story, which is the first one here on the header, "I Would Escape Again, Recaptured Convict Terror Tells a Court." And this is what was happening yesterday. And as per the account that has been captured on this daily, it took 18 months of careful planning with crucial help from warders to break out of the committee maximum security prison. And this is information that was disclosed yesterday by one of the three convicts during what has been termed as an explosive court session. After listening to the whole plea that this gentleman had, Ms. Mochache, Diana Mochache, the chief magistrate in Kahawa, jailed them for an additional 15 months each, and on the basis that they saved the court, they have shown remorse by pleading guilty to the offenses, saving this court time and resources in the pursuit of justice, consequently sentencing them to an additional 15 months to prison instead of the 2 years for escaping lawful custody. But according to this account of this gentleman, this was the account of let me see, Ahulanga, yes, he revealed the details behind this daring escape plan. He also said that the detectives had deliberately declined to acknowledge his account of the plan, suggesting that there was a cover up to protect some of the warders that helped them and police officers that helped them escape and how involved they were. He lamented that most of the prison warders who had aided their escape had not even been arrested after giving their names to the police. He went on to say that his life is in danger because he has vital information that could lead to the prosecution of other people in government who also participated in the mission. The magistrate instructed him to write down the names of all the warders who helped break them out of jail, and went on to order that the prosecution to summon the guards and everyone who has been whose name was on that list for interrogation. One of the reasons as to why he said that they escaped was because they knew that once their time was up in prison, they would be executed by the anti-terrorism police upon release. So they planned to escape and cross over the border to Ethiopia to secure their freedom. That story has been captured in great detail there on page 3. You can go ahead and have a read. But coming back to the front page, economy, top of the agenda as President Uhuru Kenyatta addresses the nation later on today. Of course, this is something that a great number of people are waiting to hear from the president. Coming to the main read, the race for Raila's running mate, Odinga, is set to announce his presidential bid at the Azimio la Umoja convention, which will be happening on the 10th of December. And as per the strategist of the ODM and Jubilee parties, they are saying that scouting for a deputy for the ODM leader in the race to state house has been narrowed down to 3 potential candidates. That is Nakuru Governor Lee Kinyanjui, NARC Kenya Chief, that is Martha Karua, and former presidential candidate Peter Kenneth. And the seat for governor for Nairobi County has been preserved for one of the One Kenya Alliance principals. I'll be giving you details of that in a bit.
That's just a ploy. We all know the game. The name of the game. In politics, we usually say it's like going to war. You don't tell your opponent your next move.
Confuse and scatter the enemy.
Exactly. You just ambush. So having the 3,
yes,
it's just to dangle the carrot, but one day, one day. Yeah.
But now the interesting bit is that saying that the seat for governor for Nairobi County has been reserved for one of the One Kenya Alliance principals.
Cool.
So whoever will decide to cross over, atapewa kiti ya governor for Nairobi County.
Okay.
Anyway, I'll be giving you details of that story in a bit. Then there's a concern about the new COVID-19 strain from South Africa, Omicron, as ministry it seems to have dropped its guard at the airport. Investigations by this particular daily established that passengers traveling from South Africa to Kenya on 6 flights that landed on Monday, including 1 cargo plane, were not tested. And for this new variant of COVID-19, the Omicron variant, which was discovered in South Africa on the 24th of November. And we also saw activist Boniface Mwangi, who was one of the guys that landed from South Africa, saying that whatever the PS for Health was saying in regards to the government stepping up security at the airport to just make sure that we do not get this new variant in the country was a lie, in his own words. And finally, Kinoti loses bid to avoid prison after High Court Judge Anthony Mirima dismissed Mr. Kinoti's application to review or set aside the ruling. Details coming up in a bit. Doreen.
Right, let's just begin from that particular note in regards to that new variant, that is the Omicron variant, whereby Kenyans now seek assurance over that particular COVID variant. And remember that even as of yesterday, we already established that with this particular one, the symptoms that you would have otherwise expect, such as coughing, fever, they do not manifest in this particular COVID variant. And this is perhaps why Kenyans are now seeking assurance over this COVID variant. And also, even as you expect the State of the Nation address by the President this afternoon, this is some of the things that Kenyans are expecting the president to address. Still on that note, concerning matters of health, China is set to give Africa a billion doses of jab, that is of the COVID-19 jab. And this also comes at a time where there were talks in regards to that, as well as also just emphasizing on matters trade and security, amongst other issues, whereby China will be coming into place to in play to see how they can assist and help African nations. So a bit of some politics now, moments of truth as OCA principal call crisis meeting. Remember that for a while now we've tried to just understand who will carry the flag for One Kenya Alliance, and now as it emerges, it looks that amongst the four principals, somehow one or two of them is in talks with either the deputy president or the ODM leader Raila Odinga. And this is why this morning they'll be holding a crisis meeting to try and establish how they will move or forge forward. That is that in regards to matters One Kenya Alliance, and still some bit of politics. This comes after that meeting that the DP had with Wamama na Hustler, and at this point he just shunned tribal parties and he urges Kenyans to shun those tribal parties. Still on matters drought, and this is in regards to the 2 billion Kenya shillings mitigation funds to curb drought, whereby now MP Adan Duale is trying to say, where did all this money go? Remember that this was the money that was put or set forth to at least help those counties that were heavily affected by drought. And again, even speaking of this issue, issues like health, like economy, still drought features greatly into what Kenyans are expected the president to address. And again, this is perhaps why the MP there is trying to question where this money went, given the fact that in his own words, he says that those counties that are supposed to be helped by this particular fund, they haven't gotten that help yet. And even as we set to celebrate World AIDS Day tomorrow. And yes, we obviously know that the strides have been made in terms of stopping the spread of HIV. But even at that, there's still some more things we need to do, and especially as a country. And this is perhaps also why the Ministry of Health is in a bit trying to ensure how best they can produce local ARVs by local farms. And this also comes at a time that since 2014, remember, there's been a bit of tussle in regards to how donors are bringing forth this money that is supposed to help Kenyans affected or infected with HIV. So this is again why they're really in a bit to try and see how best they can produce local ARVs. And again, also this comes at a time where NAC, that is the National AIDS Control Council, is now calling for an end to discrimination against people living with HIV, even as we prepare towards marking or celebrating that World HIV Day tomorrow. And of course, I mean, I've already mentioned enough of what Kenyans are really expecting the president to address. That is on the State of the Nation address, and also on this particular article, just highlighted on the front page of the PD, which captures page 14 through 16 of the same paper, really highlights and talks more about what Kenyans are really expecting the president to address on this year's State of the Nation address. Regina.
Now, in a nutshell, a majority of what my colleagues have mentioned is what has captured and described in this particular paper, being the standard that also has a special report, and it is titled A Kidnapper's Paradise. The Law of the Jungle reigns, and despite being an expansive Bill of Rights, boasting an expansive Bill of Rights, an enlightened population, responsive duty bearers, credible institutions of criminal justice, and hawk-eyed media, Kenya is slowly degenerating into an abductor's paradise. People are pulled off the streets in broad daylight, some never to be seen again. Who is involved? What will it take to end this new warring trend? That's a story that has been given prominence on this particular daily this morning, just highlighting the fate of some of the people who've gone missing. There's a whole pullout, actually two pages of it. The recent one being an Ethiopian businessman who was allegedly pulled out of a vehicle amid in traffic and bundled into a waiting Subaru. And human rights defenders and journalists, as well as activists, are questioning the role of the police. Now, according to the family, Saladin was on his way to the DCI headquarters along Kiambu Road, where the Nairobi Interpol office is located when his car was blocked and unidentified men ordered him into another car and drove off. Now, Mr. Salahaddin had been battling plans to extradite him to Turkey on allegations that he was wanted for child molestation. However, his family maintains that he's being targeted due to his ties to an influential business billionaire cleric uncle, that is Fethullah Gulen, a former ally of President Recep Tayyip Erdogan, who fled the United States after being accused of leading at the 2016 coup in his home country in Ethiopia. According to a report that has brought forth the report, this particular report by Haki Africa indicates that in the year, now as today is the last year of November 2021, in the year, they have documented over 43 cases of extrajudicial killings and disappearances in 2021 alone. So according to the report, 29 such cases were reported in the coast. Mombasa County had 17, Kwale 9, Nairobi 7, Kajiado 4, Lamu 3, while Wajir, Nyeri and Kiamu had a case each. Further details, you can get a copy of this newspaper this morning. So in a nutshell, that's what we have on the front page of the Standard this morning. And just to remind you that we are going to be televising the State of the Nation address as President Uhuru Kenyatta is going to be addressing the bicameral parliament today. And this is going to be his eighth during his tenure, probably the last as President Uhuru Kenyatta, given that we are set for the general elections come August 9th, 2022. So KBC Channel 1 is the place to be. Before we call it quits, we'll take a quick breather, but we'll return. We're going to be having a candid conversation where Victor is going to be engaging one of our guests this morning. I think I need to hand it over to Victor so that he can share some insights into that particular interview. Victor.
Yeah, you're still following with it. Yeah, no problem. Yes, that discussion is about the Big Four agenda, the process that she's taken. Of course, she's been rising through the ranks from classroom, being a lecturer, to the position she is right now. And we just had that discussion yesterday, and what is her program, what is the project, and look ahead even as we head to the end of this particular tenure in office. And that is Cecily Kariuki, the CS for Sanitation, Water Sanitation and Irrigation, which was done yesterday at Maji House. So, do we take that, Director? Okay. All right, good morning, and we are going to have a very candid discussion here with the CS for Water, Sanitation and Irrigation, Madam Cecily Kariuki, this particular day. And of course, we just want to understand what she's doing in this particular ministry, what she's done, and what you should expect from her. Madam, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me, Victor.
First of all, I love to start by asking you this question. We are celebrating or marking 16 days of activism against gender-based violence, and it's something that has been discussed over and over and again, and we can never talk about it enough. We have to talk about it over and over and again. What can you say about that as we mark the 16 days of activism?
Well, thank you. Let me begin by joining my colleagues who are the team leaders in terms of this particular space, and in particular Professor Margaret Kobia and her team. I want to join sisters and brothers who have stood out in the last 1 week to condemn gender-based violence. I want to join them, and I want to associate with the comments that they have made, because you cannot get a country where we are saying, on the one hand, we want to empower everybody to get to their optimal best in terms of their dreams and their capacities, while at the same time meting out violence, particularly to one gender called the female gender. Now, when we speak about gender violence, oftentimes our lenses take us to the female gender. it's not so the case, because or even boys and men are also being exposed nowadays.
Yeah.
And therefore, in whichever form it takes, I want to condemn it in the highest, with the highest possible voice, very loudly, and to say that it is not only retrogressive, but it holds back potential that would otherwise come into the development space, whether economic or social or family space. And therefore, to again urge the champions, and every woman in this case in leadership position has located themselves as a champion to speak against gender-based violence. But also to commend our team leader, President Uhuru Kenyatta, because he's stuck out his neck and you know, from a point of policy, but also resourcing the people who are responsible to ensure that moving forward, GBV is a thing of the past.
Yeah,
indeed.
Absolutely. Madam Sears, you can be counted as one of the lucky Sears in our current government. You've moved from one ministry to another until where you are right now. Can you say that you're lucky to be moving through the ranks like that?
I'm not so sure lucky. Lucky doesn't happen.
Yes, you are.
Lucky doesn't happen, Victor. I am privileged, I must say that.
Yes.
I want to thank my boss who has tolerated the impact that I have brought, most of which, if I was to rate myself, I would say is positive. It's taken a lot of hard work. It's taken a lot of learning.
Yeah.
Because the minute you move to a technical ministry like health, for example, you're supervising a team of doctors and nurses and clinical people. You got to show leadership. It means you have to study.
Yeah.
You got to go to do research in the night. You got to network to understand the issues to be able to deliver.
Yeah.
Moving then, move forward and come to a ministry like where I am today, irrigation, technical issues, sanitation, technical issues, water, technical issues. I'm required to supervise engineers, hydrologists, geologists, and you name them.
Yeah.
For you to inspire confidence that you know what it you're doing in leading such a profound team of experts, again, you have to really study.
Yeah.
You really got to consult. You really got to listen. You really got to. But I must thank God. Lucky perhaps, yes, because I have enjoyed very, very good support from my boss, the President of the Republic. I've enjoyed a lot of good support from my colleagues at cabinet level, but I've also enjoyed a lot of team from you know, teamwork and a lot of support and a lot of hard work from my teams.
Yeah.
I have Roho Safi held them accountable, and they have agreed to play ball and be held accountable. So lucky perhaps is a very small part of the journey. It's taken a lot of moving pieces coming together, but most of all, it has taken making a difference to Kenyans. So that today, if I look at my social media, there's a Kenyan somewhere saying, well done. And that gives me a lot of energy. There's a Kenyan who has never seen me saying, come to us, we are in need. And we are able to then respond. And therefore, I want to thank the people who have made the journey quite eventful, quite satisfying.
Are you? What keeps you awake at night?
Service delivery. Impact to the ordinary Kenyan.
Are you proud that you're achieving it to this far?
I won't take credit entirely.
Yeah.
I want to share this by half with my colleagues who have made it possible, because I'm only me. I lead them. They are willing actors. We move along. I propose stuff. They interrogate it. I give them time. They come back to me. And we agree to move as a team.
Yeah.
And therefore, if I entirely take the credit, I'll be saying a lie to Kenyan.
Yeah.
It's a very wide ministry that I'm leading today. A lot of expectations, limited resources, and for us to be able to spread the resources to 47 counties, it means that we have to consult on an ongoing basis.
Yeah.
If a weekend goes and I have not consulted, you know, part of my team, then something is not going right.
Your desk must be one of the busiest desks, because when you talk about devolution, we talk about health. Health was one of the devolved units to the counties, and quite often we've been seeing you having discussions, you know, boardroom meetings with the health sectors, players. It has taken you lots and lots of energy in conjunction with other sector players to make sure that that devolved unit is completely streamlined, and when I inch get that service delivery. How would you rate the level of devolution in terms of your ministry to this far?
There are several ways you can look at devolution, as it were.
Yeah.
Currently, the Ministry of Water, Sanitation and Irrigation enjoys concurrent service delivery.
Mm.
Concurrent to the extent that my ministry is responsible for policy direction,
mm.
setting up standardization, capacity building,
mm.
and mobilizing resources as well as investing in the bulk or the larger infrastructural
yeah.
investments.
Mm-hmm.
My colleagues in the 47 devolved units mm. are responsible, constitutionally speaking,
yeah.
for service delivery at the mile, at the last mile,
mm.
we call that. So, for example, if I'm able, through my ministry and the organs under my ministry, to get water from Sasumwa,
yeah.
In Nyandarua, for argument's sake,
mm.
and get that water in Nairobi County, it is expected that the county of Nairobi, currently supported by NMS, is the one that should ensure the connection
mm.
from where I drop the water, the bulk water.
Mm.
It goes through treatment, it goes to your house, if you're a resident of Nairobi,
yeah.
by that other devolved function.
Mm.
So it's a concurrent function, requiring a lot of coordination, a lot of consultation, a lot of collaboration.
Mm-hmm.
Has it worked in that manner necessarily?
Yeah.
Not so,
mm-hmm.
not so, because even when we know that the last mile connection mm. belongs to a devolved unit,
yeah.
oftentimes our investment from the national level has gone underutilized,
mm.
and a lot of times we've had to go
mm.
to also deal with the last mile connection,
yeah.
as it were.
Mm-hmm.
I must say, and I want to be understood, that devolution is a great developmental mechanism.
Mm.
It must be supported by your cost, but I must also say,
yeah.
if in any case there is a gap that we experience at the national level,
mm-hmm.
responsibility loops back to the national level, and particularly the president.
Mm.
So we must be very conscious where we detect there is a gap,
yeah.
and sincerely there is a gap that the devolved unit can do nothing about,
mm.
we go in and work together.
Mm-hmm.
Because at the end of the day, it is a Kenyan citizen who we are serving.
Yeah.
Both units are serving, but I would want to see a better intergovernmental collaboration framework
mm.
to ensure that we do not deliver commodity,
mm-hmm.
and then expecting the next person to take it on, who yeah. is the devolved unit,
yeah.
really fails to or yeah. has different kind of priorities. It is for this reason that I have set up a task force, a national task force,
mm.
that is looking at a more coherent approach to how we invest in the sector
yeah.
5 years from now, so that we are doing a mapping of our investment priority.
Mm-hmm.
We are going to be designing the projects that are required, both water and sanitation projects.
Mm-hmm.
And we are doing this together or jointly with the devolved units,
mm-hmm.
so that then when we come up with a template called our investment plan for the coming 5 years, it is a coherent plan for which then when we mobilize resources, there's clear understanding of
yeah.
who is doing what where to respond to the needs of the Kenyan citizens
okay.
in matters of water and sanitation.
Your ministry actually is one of the drivers, the biggest drivers of the Big Four agenda. And I know that is something quite close to your heart,
mm-hmm.
and even the president's government. How do you rate your development record when you started in, when you got into this ministry, and even starting from 2013 up to where we are right now? Can you sit back and say that, yes, we are going for the next election, and you can give yourself a pat on the back and say you have delivered?
I really will, Victor. I actually want you to be the first one to clap.
Okay, for the sake of that, let me do that.
And you will clap yeah. because mm-hmm. Figures don't lie.
Mm.
If I look at this ministry, when Jubilee came in 2013,
yeah.
the water coverage was at 53%.
Mm.
53% means 5 out of 10 Kenyans would have access to clean, reliable yeah. water.
Mm.
At this point in time, we are at 70%, meaning there is an additional two
national
Kenyans.
National coverage.
Right. There is an additional 2 Kenyans who are able to access clean potable water.
Uh-huh.
The target that we have in the remainder of the Jubilee administration is to have another 1 Kenyan
yeah.
out of 10,
mm-hmm.
meaning we'll be at 80% from 53%,
uh-huh.
80% of water coverage. It is not a mean achievement.
It's not.
Remember, after independence, we had successive governments running.
Mm.
We had administrations, 3 of them. We only managed to get to 53% of water coverage.
Mm.
And I'm talking about an additional over 12 million Kenyans.
Yeah.
Portable, accessible, dependable, reliable water
mm.
available to them today. I would pat the people who have made it possible. like I said, it cannot just be me. Mm-hmm. If you look at regulated sanitation coverage,
yeah.
And I say regulated because when you go to the rural areas, there's a lot of what is unregulated. People have sanitation. If you go to your village,
talk of the cartels, yeah? and all that.
Let me put it this way: if you go to your village, you know, your rural village, mm-hmm. it's possible you are not on connection to sewer the way we know it. You know, the sewer in the developed urban settings. Mm-hmm. We are not able to account for that because it is not regulated.
Okay.
But the sewer which I speak about is what is regulated,
yeah.
mainly in urban centers, mainly in settlements where we have, you know, sewer lines connecting to your house and dropping the wastewater and the waste material to a place for processing and doing whatever requires to be done.
Yeah.
That is a sanitation coverage that we speak about from this office, because that is what is documentable.
Yeah.
Now, when we moved in, we were at 15%. Jubilee government, regulated sanitation coverage, 15%.
15%.
We are currently at 27% sanitation coverage.
Yeah.
By the time it's time for President Uhuru Kenyatta to call it a day, we'll be at 40%.
And that is a target.
40%.
Yeah.
That is a target for this medium-term plan, meaning we will have covered our target for the duration,
okay.
given the resources. Now, if you look at irrigation, very interesting again. When we moved in as Jubilee government, we had 350,000 roundabout acres under irrigation, again within what is confines of regulation, and we are able to document and we can tell and we can monitor. Currently we are 600,000 acres.
That's a big improvement.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, I mean, just looking at the water space alone, I will be able to say we have done well. The next question a Kenyan out there in Pokot will ask, I don't have access to clean water. How can you be clapping? And I'll tell them the reason I have put in this team to do an investment planning and a roadmap for execution is because we know Pokot, we haven't covered a lot of you.
Yeah.
It's because I know Lamu, we still need water. In Nakuru, we need clean, dependable water. So I won't sit here and pretend we've covered everybody, and that is why you see there is still a gap. Remember, population target also moves. So as soon as we think Nairobi, here we come, we've covered, we have one of the best coverages in Nairobi.
Yeah.
We have mushrooming population in the informal settlement. How do we respond? We move. That is a point of investment planning. That is a point of continuous engagement and conversation.
Yeah.
That is the point of continuous monitoring so that we see where are gaps and need biggest. So I keep saying our targets are moving, but we have committed ourselves to SDG 2030. SDG 2030, which is eight years from where we are, presupposes an average person from wherever they will be in this country and across the globe will be able to access water that is clean, of good quality, on a continuous basis.
All right.
And so that is where we are walking towards.
Okay. Madam, allow us to take a very short break. And when you come back, I want us to talk about the issue of the challenges you're facing. Galana Kulalu, we have to talk about it. And of course, the issue of dams. The government is constructing so many dams across the country, and perhaps many people will benefit from that once they're done and dusted. So let's take a break, and we come back. We're still having that discussion with the CS for Water, Sanitation and Irrigation, Cecily Karioke. We'll be right back.
Kupata sikiza tuni hii, Isaiah chapter 40 verse 8, wajaza star, 811 star, 963 hash.
Wakati mwingine unaweza kujipata umefinywa pande zote, na unaona kama shida yako ni kubwa sana, kama hakuna nguvu ambazo zaweza kuitatua. Lakini ni vyema kujua kwamba kuna Mungu mwenye nguvu na ambaye hachoki kamwe. Isaia mlango wa 40 mstari wa 8 inasema, Je, wewe hukujua, hukusikia, yeye Mungu wa milele, Bwana, muumba miisho ya dunia, hazimii wala hachoki.
Ili kupata sikiza tuni hii, Isaiah chapter 40 verse 8, mwenye za star, 81 and star, 963, hash.
Welcome back. We are still having that discussion with the CS for Water, Sanitation and Irrigation, Cicely Kariuki. We are talking about matters national concern. Okay, madam, thank you so much for joining us still. Let's now talk about the Big Four agenda. This is something that is quite close to the president's heart, and your ministry lies squarely at the center of the Big Four agenda. Talk of health, talk of food, talk of irrigation and all that. What is the progress of the Big Four agenda as far as your ministry is concerned?
Thank you, Victor. Let me put it this way. It's the Big Four agenda items under President Uhuru Kenyatta's administration were meant actually to give him an easy way of monitoring and directing resources where he felt developmental impact would be highest. That is when he came into office for the second term. Now, this ministry considers itself a super enabler to the Big Four. And following the conversation that we've had, one can very quickly tell that it makes it's very difficult for me to be able to isolate what is Big Four agenda and what we are doing in that space, because everything we do ends up impacting one of the four. But to be very, very precise, what we have done in government is to be able to isolate specific projects for which we then designate them as Big Four agenda items or projects. For example, under the food and nutrition security, I can say there are three projects only. One on livestock, one on fishing, one on food processing. But the discussion I'm having with you confirms to you the entire 9 billion shillings going to support irrigation projects is effectively dealing with food security and nutrition. And that's why I said I find it very difficult to say I have a budget of only 220 million for food security. It cannot be true. There's an additional 9 billion, you know, for which from Galana, Kit Katilu, in Turkana, West Pokot, to Masinga, to Dhiba, all these projects will end up finally being or bringing to fruition the president's legacy on food and nutrition. But if you're to come back and look at again what we are doing in the space of supporting UHC, we have again been directed to spend 500 and about 60 million shillings this financial year to ensure that we deliver water to level 2, level 3, level 4 facilities.
Across the country.
Now, whenever we have projects and within the vicinity is a health facility, we will supply water, whether or not it was designated within these 560 million shillings. Again, making it very difficult for me to separate myself, you know, and be able to isolate the conversation. When you look at the issues of the water projects that we are implementing across the board, again, they are supposed to either enable manufacturing because we are delivering water to manufacturing and processing areas. Currently, we have a very aggressive endeavor to be able to take sanitation services, that is sewerage, and water to areas around industrial area. We've, of course, availed water in the Naivasha Industrial Park, mm-hmm. for example, mm-hmm. In Mombasa Special Economic Zone,
yeah.
In industries around Mavoko, again, making my work a little bit difficult. So let me put it this way.
Yeah.
We are privileged to spend 70 billion shillings this financial year, mm-hmm. inclusive of what now you'd want to isolate and say is a big four agenda or is this or the other. But I look at it globally and say,
yeah.
my business of waking up and coming here is to enable the big four agenda
yeah.
in whichever character and without being confined to
yes.
the level four and level yeah. three.
And when
hospital.
You talk, you're the chief enabler of the big four agenda.
Absolutely.
What do you mean by that?
Exactly what I'm explaining, yeah. Victor.
Yes.
I'm explaining and saying there is no food security in this country mm-hmm. without water.
Absolutely.
Through irrigation.
They are connected.
Absolutely, isn't it?
Yeah.
There is no health without clean, potable water available in your house.
Mm-hmm.
So even when I'm not taking water to a health facility,
mm-hmm.
I am dealing with you directly.
Yeah.
Because the minute you do not have clean, potable water, the next thing is that you are caught up with a waterborne disease, you end up in hospital, you negate the effort of the president of getting Kenyans to be healthy.
Yeah.
When it comes to issues of manufacturing, for example, it is the food that is produced through irrigation that will end up in a manufacturing place.
Yeah.
You know?
Yes.
And it will meet with clean water.
Uh-huh.
And it will end up in the export market.
Yeah.
So I view myself as a ministry and my team here as that super enabler. Because we are not confined in one space.
Mm.
Hence my description of this.
Yeah.
Or this analogy that I'm sharing with you.
Madam Sears, when you go to Turkana and you see farmers now trying to change the whole landscape of that particular region, which was purported to be the most dry part of the country, and now they're able to produce food.
Mm-hmm.
Are you confident that Kenya as a nation, we are able to be self-sufficient?
I will take your imagination and that of Kenyans to Israel.
Yes.
You know, and you know
it's
what
a desert.
It's a complete desert. I will take you to a place like Dubai,
mm-hmm.
a place where they started by importing soil to be able to plant. Now, the entire place is green. I overflew that and I was amazed. It's not the Dubai that I saw 10, 20 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
There's no reason, therefore, that Kenya itself cannot open up their sour land for as long as there is water and an enabling environment, including access through roads. That is why, again, I get surprised when Kenyans talk about over-investing in roads. You can never over-invest in infrastructure that is enabling development. I have every confidence that moving forward in years to come, Kenya will be self-sufficient in matters food. Kenyans will be self-sufficient in matters of the nutrition requirements. Indeed, Kenya is poised to have access for the export market. That is where we are taking Kenya.
Yeah. And when you talk about food sufficiency and you talk about matters health, where in terms of your projection are we headed to? Because devolution is still here, and as you've said, and most people actually appreciate the level of devolution we speak, what is your projection in terms of devolved units? Some people say that health should be reverted back to the national government, and you are dealing with it so that it should remain where it is so that people can get the services they require on the ground. Are we moving in the right direction?
Well, I was privileged again to deal with health from January of 2013.
Yes.
Up to January 2020.
Yeah.
That is last year.
Yeah.
And my experience is that no amount of perhaps sitting here to lament over what should have been devolved or not devolved is going to give us a reversal. My proposal is that we need to make do with that framework because it is what Kenyans voted for in 2010. And by so doing, then have intergovernmental frameworks of collaboration and project execution that are cohered towards service delivery. And the final target is for the Kenyan.
Yeah.
So reverse, it's debatable. We can sit here and debate throughout.
Yeah.
When I sat on that side, I didn't quite encourage that for a discussion because I believed with a cohered approach and goodwill and the directing investment where there is accountability, it is possible that you can still get. Because the import of the devolved unit in service delivery is that it sleeps and wakes up in that space where Wanjiko, where Onyango is, where Fatima is, you know? And therefore, you are more sensitive to the issues emerging as opposed to a very centralized command-control process. You know, so neither. But looking at it again moving forward, perhaps the question we'd be asking is that what do we require for these devolved units to function more optimally? It's an issue of prioritization.
Mm.
It is an issue of, again, collaborating a lot more with the national government.
Yeah.
It is putting their resources where their mouth is.
Absolutely, you know? Yeah.
And perhaps simplifying issues. We don't have to have in every county a level 6 teaching and referral hospital. Mm. It is not necessary.
Yeah.
You know, we can have these in regional centers and we can then deal with health from the very basic point.
Yeah.
One that I propagated every day that I was on that space.
Okay.
But now I'm here. So what is my role? It's getting water.
Yeah.
To the facilities. It is getting clean water to the facilities. It's ensuring we open up more land so Kenyans are not, you know, faced with malnutrition, which is a health issue.
Yeah.
And, you know, it is ensuring there is proper sanitation and the coverage goes up so that, again, we're not exposed to, you know, walking on poo-poo everywhere.
Talk of sanitation, when you're walking into the compound, it was sparkling clean.
Yes.
I want you to be generous enough. Give yourself a figure of your choice. Out of 100%, how would you rate yourself up to where we are today in terms of service delivery?
When I taught, I was a very mean teacher. I still continue to be.
No, don't be mean with yourself.
And I have to be mean because I don't believe in being comfortable.
Yes.
If two Kenyans or three Kenyans at this point in time do not have clean water, I cannot begin to feel comfortable and say I have done very well.
Yeah.
You know, I must remind myself there are still three Kenyans out of 10 waiting for clean water. All right?
Yeah.
So I would perhaps feel very generous today and give myself 70%.
That's in collaboration with other state departments.
Everyone else.
And yes, sector players as well.
Everyone else. But in the water, sanitation and irrigation space, I would be very unfair if I went to rate my colleague doing another thing. It would not be right.
Okay.
It would not be right. I'll give them the space to rate themselves. Yeah. Yes.
The president is quite busy trying to spread dams across the country. And much as we have got, you know, several allegations, like the Kimorer and the Aror and some other challenges, how many dams are near completion as we speak nationally?
Oh, huge question. I won't have a specific response for you because they are all over. Mm-hmm. They are dotted all over the space. Mm. The way for you to appreciate why I may not have a straight answer is for you to appreciate I am supervising 450 ongoing projects in water and sanitation alone in the country.
450.
I am supervising 200 irrigation projects across the country. And when I say 200 irrigation projects, I am not talking about household ponds, which are running into 26,000 plus. I'm not talking. That is one project for me.
Yeah.
Okay? When you look at water, you know, meant for, say, if you look at projects, say, for dealing with flood control up in Budalagi, again, I'll call that one project.
Yeah.
Yet there are several projects. So the straight answer is that we are having 650 projects across the country that are as material as I have tried to explain. Talk about Thipa Dam.
That is huge.
You know, talk about a cluster we call Katilo in Turkana. Talk about 48 sanitation projects which we are implementing together with the African Development Bank. Talk about a huge project around Nairobi and its environs, again, which is we are implementing in partnership with AFD. You know, so huge portfolio in terms of projects, all at various stages of a completion.
But see, as again, as a government, you also have collaborations with other sector players like the private sector. Talk of the AFD, talk of the FB, and other people who are coming on board to make sure that you push the agenda of the government moving forward. Would you say that they have chipped in properly so that the whole wheel of development is completely moved?
I want to appreciate the development partners who have appetite and are working very, very intensively in the water, sanitation and irrigation sector.
Yeah.
To name but a few, we have World Bank, a lot of World Bank support. Mm. We have a lot of African Development Bank support. Yeah. We have a lot of support by JICA. We are serious with the European Investment Bank. Mm. We are here with the Badea as another investment partner. So the entirety of them, I can only appreciate them because they have made execution of this project I speak about possible. Because as you will realize, the government resource basket is quite strained, because everybody is dipping in and we are competing for everyone else, with everyone else. And therefore, it is because of these collaborations and partnerships that we have seen ourselves moving forward. And of course, German government through KfW is also quite an important one to speak about, also Belgium government and the entire European Union space. So I can appreciate and say that it is because of them I'm able to speak all the statistics that we are speaking about today.
Absolutely.
It is because of them that we are coming up with a coherent investment plan so that when we get to develop proposals with them, then they'll be ready to chip in and support the government to move to the next level of project implementation.
All right. Challenges that you have been facing. Talk of challenges, we talk of Kimorer and Aror, we talk of Galana Kulalu. Does that give you a sleepless night?
Any bad practice from a point of governance is not my friend. Cannot be my friend, and I don't belong to that space. But having said that, is that to also say, if I was to look at Galana, for example, which I was involved in at the point of design, a novelly ambitious project whose dream has not died yet. Why do I say so? I say so because the initial attempt of getting 10,000 pilot project going has lived to achieve its target of being a pilot.
Yeah.
We have piloted over 38 different crop varieties in Galana. We have isolated the ones that can perform well in that ecological area for as long as there is water. And therefore, there are lessons that have been taken out. The initial phase gave us about 4,800 acres. We are now completing the balance to bring infrastructure to 10,000 acres. We will then commercialize. And we'll commercialize because one of the lessons learned is that we aren't good at doing commercial business as government. And therefore, it has been decided under the directive of the president that the next phase, once we are done, hopefully in the coming 1-2 months, we will move to commercialization of that pilot farm, now for commercial purposes. But a portion of it will continue to inform our research. We must continue with the agronomical research to be able to test as many varieties of crop as possible. Because it is those Asal areas, finally, that will give us the food security that we so much deserve.
And challenges you're facing as a community, as a ministry, you said that the money given is not enough. It can never be enough.
It can't be enough. And I mean, I don't want to prioritize that to be my one of my problems. It cannot be one of my problems. Suffice it to say that on an annual budget of 100 million, billion, 100 billion would do just about well for me to be able to cover the projects which are designed, which require to plug the gap. I am at 70 billion. I am not going to really complain. I'm not going to dwell there. But the real challenges that we incur as we move day to day, for me, touch on land. Because, you know, land acquisition has become some business by some people, call them cartels, you know. But I think their days are numbered now with the digitization of, you know, processes that my sister Farida is working on with her team. So land acquisition occasions delays to projects even when they are funded. Way leave acquisition occasions delay in implementation of projects even when they are funded and they are on course. Land becomes a messy issue when we have resources and are, for example, taking sewerage to Utawala in Embakasi. Because people have encroached and they've taken on land that belonged to public use. And you will recall what we had last year, taking over or going back to reclaim Dandora in Ruai. A 4,200 acres of land that marks the lowest point in Nairobi, and it was designated for us to be able through gravity to deliver wastewater and poopoo for processing. But some engineers, cartels, decided it's public land, it's open, they acquired it, they sold it, it turns hands, and unfortunately we had to move in and take it, because we are currently expanding. As the population expands, there is more wastewater generated, and we have to find a home for it to be processed. Otherwise, the city will become untenable, unlivable. So land is one of the big problems, not to talk about succession issues. Uh-huh. Whenever we designate a location, uh-huh. and there are reasons why we designate a particular location,
yeah.
you know, like when you're delivering water through gravity, uh-huh. you know, the lowest point from the highest peak where the water is being uh-huh. sourced makes your natural place. So sometimes we'll come to you, and because of succession issues, family
yeah.
issues,
yeah.
it becomes very, very difficult to be able to access yeah. the land. We've also been exposed to politicization of projects,
which is quite rampant.
It is completely unacceptable.
Yeah,
it is unacceptable. It's unthinkable
mm.
because politicians are supposed to help with development. That is why you put
yeah.
them to office.
Yeah.
But when they also come to negate projects and a realization of projects,
mm.
it is completely unacceptable. Currently, I have a project which is in West Pokot,
mm-hmm.
the first ever sanitation project in West Pokot. And we are caught up. We are not able to implement this project. And so we are having to look for an alternative project. Never mind, it is a funded project.
Yeah.
I have a small project in Nyandarua. Again,
yeah.
somebody has run off to court. 1 year later, I cannot proceed with the project. So what happens?
Conservatory orders, you know? All over.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So those are some of the issues we are exposed to. We are, of course, also exposed to challenges to do with the interface
mm.
of this devolved function.
Yeah.
If there isn't good understanding
yeah.
with the devolved unit,
yeah.
sometimes it occasions delays to project implementation,
yeah.
execution, or you just use too much energy
mm.
you know, trying to get things moving, which ought not to be the case.
Yeah.
Those are among some of the ones that come quickly to me
yeah.
When you talk about challenges.
We have got 8 months to go,
yeah.
and perhaps you have got so many things that you really want to achieve between this particular period. Order priority?
A completion of projects that are ongoing.
Mm-hmm.
We have done our mapping of the projects which are completable
yes.
within the time left.
Mm-hmm.
Currently, and I will be getting this report next week, I have queued about 40 projects
mm-hmm.
which are about to be complete within this calendar year,
yes.
meaning the next 1 month.
Yeah.
I have 40 projects that must be complete.
Mm.
I have another set of projects which are at the range of 85% level of completion.
Yes.
Several of them again, about the same range, about 30.
Mm.
I then want all the energy in the coming quarter
mm.
to be directed towards those projects.
Yeah.
Some medium level, some quite large. In terms of away from projects, and when I speak about projects, I'm mm. talking about the entirety of the space,
mm-hmm.
be they water, sanitation, or irrigation project,
mm-hmm.
the entire basket. But away from there, reforming the sector has been a key agenda.
Yeah.
We are operating on a framework of Water Act, which was revised in 2016.
Mm.
And it brought in a lot of aspects of reforming the sector.
Yeah.
It is my business to close on most of the reform issues mm-hmm. which are contained in the Water Act. I am happy, without necessarily clapping for me and my team,
yeah.
that for the first time we have a sessional paper on water
mm.
policy that is going to inform the policy direction and
yeah.
trajectory for the sector.
Mm-hmm.
Even when I'm gone, I want to appreciate both Cabinet and National Assembly because
yeah.
they have just processed that policy
mm-hmm.
and it will then be the anchor
mm.
around what we do going forward.
Yeah.
I am also very pleased to make sure that we go to market with a set of regulations
mm-hmm.
that we have developed
yeah.
touching on particular water harvesting, because that's important
mm.
that we should be able to harvest water when it's a rainy season.
Yeah.
And so this again is going to be done within a framework of a determined legal framework through the regulations.
Mm.
I also have gotten approval for another set of regulations,
yeah.
two sets of regulations. Currently, my colleagues and I at Cabinet will be looking and hopefully to pass
mm-hmm.
Four sets of strategies,
yeah.
which strategies again are going to give me
mm.
Interventions that are smarter and where priority and effectiveness is going
yeah.
to be achieved.
Yeah.
That is all in keeping with the reforms under the Water Act. And hopefully, again, yeah. at the end of this year, that is the coming 4 weeks, I expect to be receiving back
mm-hmm.
the investment plan
yeah.
Projection for the coming 5 years
mm.
to be able then to develop proposals to go to market to look for more resources.
Yeah.
So once I am done with that, which I consider to be a priority, I think that I'll look back and say I have served my sentence.
All right. As we come to a close, the president is about to address the parliament at 2:30. If you look perhaps in his head, what do you think the president is most likely to address at 2:30 in parliament today?
Well, that's a tight one for me to be able to guess. I guess that because this happens to be his final state of the art conversation to Kenyans.
Yeah, with the nation address, yeah.
Who put him to office twice?
Yeah.
I want to assume that he will be getting his scorecard and he will be speaking to Kenyans and saying, when you voted me to office, we started at this point. Mm-hmm. I made this commitment and that I have delivered this far.
Yeah.
I think that may be the thread of the conversation. I hope my guess is right.
Okay, you try to play it smart very early. We're still waiting for the president to give us his State of the Nation address in Parliament at 2:30. But then, 2022 politics is here and rumors has it out there that you're salivating for a seat. When are you quitting your office to go and run for?
Why would I do that? I have a job. Why would I salivate? I have a job and I enjoy it. I enjoy doing what I do.
Yeah.
Rumor has it.
Rumor has it, yes.
So you actually have an answer. Rumor has it.
Perhaps you can just give us the real answer.
I'm not at that point yet. Yeah. And the reason I'm not at that point yet, and you'll appreciate that I have a full-time job. I love doing what I do.
Yeah.
I love working on the impact and the targets that I've set for myself for the time that I'm in office. Mm-hmm. And therefore, for me, my energy is all driven around that for the time being. Should the time come that I have made up my mind and I'm moving in a certain direction, I'll sit with you. I'll let you know how we are doing.
Okay.
Yes.
I think that's the best perfect particular point to leave it at this particular point. Yeah. Thank you so much for joining us. It's been an amazing discussion that we've been having here with the CS for Water, Sanitation and Irrigation, Cecily Kariuki. We do appreciate you. And of course, for women who are also angling for these positions, she said it right, go out there and fight it with your fellow brothers. Okay. That's where we leave it at this particular point. Thank you for joining us. We are taking a break. We'll be right back.
Good morning. Now, away from matters water and sanitation, we're going to be engaging quite eloquent persons in this side of the studio talking about infrastructural investments and their correlation to housing and urban planning. I'm joined by none other than George Mburu, is the CEO of Mzizi Homes Africa. Karibu sana. And on the far end is none other than Mr. Sylvester Kasuku, who is the government's advisor in matters infrastructure. And more so, he is the immediate former CEO of the LAFSET project. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
So, gentlemen, before we start speaking matters of infrastructure as well as housing and planning, what are your expectations this afternoon when the president is going to be giving his last address, State of the Nation address, the 8th, so to speak? You know, we have seen this over the years. This is a platform he uses to tell us where we are as a country. Let's start off with you, Bwana Mburu.
Sure.
What are your expectations?
Yeah, thank you very much for having me. It's always a pleasure. And first of all, the most important thing that everybody expects is that the president is going to touch on how we are going to get out of the turmoil that we have been because of the corona pandemic. Corona pandemic came and so many businesses, so many jobs, everything, the economy was hit hard. And now, since at least there is some hope, because they have he recently removed the curfews and the restrictions that were there. Now we want to know what are the way forward. How is the government going to assist the businesses, as well as assist the employed people and also itself, the government? What is it going to do to make sure that the economy is back to normal? Because we need an enabling environment, and especially at this time that we are also heading to the election, we are coming from a downward economy, And now we are at a point whereby we need to come together and hold hands. We need now the government and the president being the head to come out very clearly on the way forward, because for sure, if we do not hold hands, if we do not have a strategy coming from a corona, and there is also a strain that is also reported to be coming, we need to know what is the way forward. And him being the head, we expect him to give us the way forward, and I believe he's going to do that. He's up to task so that our economy can grow. And we had plans before corona. We had the Vision 2030. We had the big four agendas, which for sure we have not attained because of one or two things. And but we still need to continue moving, because the country is growing, people are being born. We need to continue living and growing. And for sure, as Kenyans, we have hope, because peace, we have had peace, and peace is the most important thing. And that cohesion and living together, I think that is something you expect from the president. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
I hear economic recovery. I hear plans a government has when it comes in light of this development of a new strain. Still, our vaccination numbers have not gotten to what government has. We have been given a deadline to have Kenyans at least 10 million, so to speak, by December 21st on lack services. That is what your expectations are, as well as impetus to manufacturers. What will be a shara?
Sure.
As a government advisor, and as far as matters of infrastructure are concerned, Kasuku, what are your expectations ahead of this address?
Thank you very much. Number one, there are certain existing scenarios with regard to how the economy is currently positioned. Number one, there were previous plans of how to upscale, the development, particularly for the MSMEs. There was a previous promise by 2017 of some 10,000 enterprises to be energized and to upscale to the next level, and that was also to give a shot in the arm to the manufacturing sector. We know that there is a downtrend, particularly in the manufacturing sector, where actually we are shrinking in numbers. Coming down all the way from over 9% to 7.6%. And in the face of the world today, where economies are fast moving towards, upscaling their manufacturing so that they can take advantage of technology, that is a worrying scenario. We've got the issue of a very high cost of power, and you've seen His Excellency the President trying to address it using many scenarios. We've seen that we have a lot of thermal power, irrespective of government in investment, particularly in cheaper power, geothermal, wind, solar, name it. And we are caught in a situation of take or pay, with regard to the existing thermal power generators. And that actually affects us, particularly when we are talking about external shocks that come with the cost of oil, among many others. We have a situation of a large pool of unemployed youth, this really does create the current disaffection that you see among the young people, a sense of hopelessness, a sense of a sense of giving up, a sense of getting it even into a situation of losing the moral value of what we used to really covet, reaching to a point whereby we have a large number of unemployed youth who are energetic with the technology in their hands. You see a lot of complaints. So we have so many things to address. However, all this being the case, we have a lot of good things on the other side, because the situation now is like a coin. It has both a head and a tail, yes. There is a lot of investments in infrastructure. Just right next to your studio here,
we can see
you can see the skyline of Nairobi changing, particularly with the expressway. Though it has come late, it was supposed to have been done by the year 2012. But the financing structure changed, and it therefore needed to be done differently, and currently it's now being done. We've seen Lamu Port has now been the first three berths are ready, now operational, and needs to be jacked up. We've seen new plans, particularly special economic zones. If you look at Dongokundu, rearing up with the Dongokundu Link Road that crosses the sea. We've seen the opening of borders, particularly with Ethiopia, so that actually we are having a rejuvenated regional economy in which, by connecting to Ethiopia, we have actually created a new regional economy with regard to the 110 million people on the other side, the close to 50 million on this side that have not been working with the cross-border facilitation. Now, there are new opportunities that are arising. We've also seen that climate change issues are becoming quite something that needs to be dealt with. And actually, economic resilience needs to kick in. And we've seen many strategies being brought up in different parts of the globe that we as Kenyans cannot really ignore. And we have to be part of it. Mm-hmm. So there are quite
looking at our hits and misses, so to speak. That's what you're saying, being in government at this point. Mm. Now let's talk up that conversation about infrastructural investments vis-a-vis housing and planning. Mm. So let's start off from a regional aspect, so to speak. The regional instability that we're currently seeing, Ethiopia, Sudan, Somalia, being the immediate former CEO of the LAFSEG project and also other projects within the region. How does this augur into these projects when you're talking about cross-border facilitation?
What I would like to say is that regional integration is actually currently a global drive. Even if you talk about the SDGs, there is the call for integration. If you talk about the AU Agenda 2063, there is the call for integration. If you talk about the African Development Bank and other key institutions of the globe, they are all talking about regional integration. The conflicts are here with us, and we can never rule them out all the time. You saw how conflict affected many countries, including Rwanda. Uganda was at one time having the same scenario. With Somali is persisting. And Ethiopia was at it at one time, and again, it is once again back here. Sudan, the previous Sudan, and the current Sudan, and South Sudan, all these are with us. What I would like to say is that we have to keep our eyes on the ball. We've got to keep our eyes on the ball, in that even if these conflicts occur, or they continue to recur, we still need to pursue the issue of regional integration. What we need to do is that we need to find out settlement mechanisms, because conflicts are not a preserve of any specific society or any specific country, but they are usually caused by a number of issues, particularly when citizens maybe might not be very well satisfied, or even when people are struggling for power, or when situations are even influenced from outside jurisdictions where those kind of conflicts occur. In my view, the issue of timelines, like the 2063 agenda of AU, among them is silencing the guns and championing regional integration. We need to ensure that as we go along, we continue to lessen issues of conflicts. And we need to develop the infrastructure that enable the continent to actually achieve greater integration. And what you need to know is that when countries are affected by issues of inaccessibility and somehow not having a lot of integration with others, they usually also tend to cause a lot of tension within the populace. Uh-huh. Because opportunities are fewer, and people cannot exploit potentials that they could have done if there was greater integration and greater understanding across borders.
Now,
When we come back, we're going to be putting into perspective within the local setup, and this is a country, where do we stand in as far as infrastructural projects are concerned, and what turnover effect does it have, especially on urban planning, where Mr. one of our guests here, Judge Mboro there, is going to be telling us about, you know, infrastructure vis-a-vis housing and urban planning, so to speak. So do not go away. We'll be right back.
Mambe ana believe sana vitu ambavyo kwa kweli ni vya Kiafrika. My Jesus, kitu gani ambacho kilikufanya ukabadilika power ukasema kwamba ubadilike uwe msanii na uimbe ngoma ambazo kuonitaniza mwelimisha?
Staki salamu mimi nipe tano kisha kaoshe mikono sanitation na holy water kisha kaini.
All the big artists that make big hits, they don't really freestyle, because that's, to us, that's just like mumble jumble, you know what I mean? That's just the show. I'm just being honest with you, that's just mumble jumble.
The Amazons. My daughter here will be representing me, and that means that she will be leading this project.
Up here right now, or I will throw you out myself.
No.
I hope those two kill each other.
Please.
You really want us to make one last effort to be a family? You need to explain to me what you're talking about.
He might know the truth, and he might know that I'm here to get my revenge on Victoriano because of what he did to my father.
The Amazons.
Najua kwamba Lea yuko hai. Nina imani kwamba Lea yuko hai.
Mama yuko hai. Go pack your stuff. We are leaving.
I don't leave mama alone.
Wewe sio jifanya una mdomo mwingi sana na roho ngumu. Haya, acha tukuone sasa. Unamkumbuka huyo?
Na sijui kwa nini nazidi kulaumu kwa sababu wewe binafsi wako.
Bado.
Na kama ni kazi ndogo, mbona wewe uko chini?
Hebu toka hapa.
Pata kufa kisoja.
Good morning. If you're tuning in, you're still watching KBC Channel 1, and we're talking about matters infrastructure as well as housing and planning investments. Joining me in studio, with me in studio, is none other than the CEO of Mizizi Africa Homes. That is Mr. or rather Dr. George Mboro. Karibu sana. And far right is none other than the former immediate CEO of the Lapset Project and currently the advisor on matters infrastructure, Sylvester Kasuku. So before we took a short break, we're looking at regional integration and talking about the current instability, cases of pockets. I would say pockets, and I'm saying that with a pinch of salt. And you said that we need to keep our eyes on the ball. Regional integration is key, especially cross-border facilities. Now let's come back home. Financing these infrastructural projects. We have seen critics who have come and said that we are not so sure that some of these projects are going to see the light of day. One, we are transiting. We are going to be having a different government in place after August 9th. Should we be worried, Mr. Kasuku? Let's pick it from there.
Number one, change of power or change of regime should never be a cause of worry in a mature democracy. And what I can say is that in many developed countries, Change of regime does not mean change of policy, or does not mean development starts to suffer. And in a situation where that becomes the issue, then that should worry us. If change of regime or change of leadership can lead to disruption of development. And that is part of also requiring ourselves to keep our eyes on the ball. That we should be a country that is consistent, a country that is predictable with regard to our stability, and a country of mature democracy. Now, moving forward, issues of financing infrastructure has never been a walk in the park for many countries. And even if you look at countries like America, even if you look at China, you look at many countries in Europe, there was a real time of tightening of belts, particularly if requisite infrastructure, and what I mean by requisite is that that is much needed infrastructure has to be built, then you have to find ways of financing.
So there's no way out.
And we've also seen how countries like India, we've also seen how countries like Brazil have equally tackled issues of investing in infrastructure. So I, as we speak in Africa now, for us to start to, scale the heights of the skyscrapers that we are thinking about in terms of development, we need to make certain critical investments in the continent. And the AU estimates that by the year 2040, we are between the year 2012 and the year 2040, we needed to have made an investment of close to $360 billion on infrastructure. That is over 32,000 kilometers of new roads, over 30,000 kilometers of new railway, over 1.3 billion ton added capacity to African ports, among among many others. So if we really have to finance this, then we have to brace the real pressure that comes with this. And I know people have been complaining about loans. People have been complaining about difficulties with
the issue of budget. We will not even, let's before we tackle that loans. Kenyans are already, so to speak, feeling the heat. We have seen mega projects. Now we are using the superhighway, the Madaraka Express. We are having the expressway here that is still under construction. But government is operating on a deficit that has to be plugged by external financing as well as domestic. And Kenyans are crying foul and say, are this priority? Before you answer that question, let me rope in Mr. Mboro. Talking about priority, government has also prioritized the issue of affordable housing.
Sure.
From where you sit, what is the main challenge? You know, 2022 is just but around the corner.
Yeah.
What has been the main challenge of actually achieving this?
Yeah, thank you very much. And affordable housing is one of the big four agendas by the government, as we know. And it is a very critical part of the government's agenda, because it has so much ripple effect than only people being housed. Because when you are talking about housing, you are also talking about manufacturing. Because when you come to building a house, you need to use cement, you need to use concrete, and that is part of manufacturing. And manufacturing is also part of the big four agendas. Another thing that the government is trying so hard is to create job employments, because we have noted that our biggest challenge as a country is a youthful, a young nation that has so such healthy people who are jobless. So you find that issues of insecurity come in place, and these people, if they are well utilized, because they have the will and they work, we can be able to make use of our natural resources, what we have, and actually be able to bring our country out of the third world country that we currently are measured. And housing also, when you are talking about housing, there is also the issue of infrastructure, which has very well been touched here. And because when you want to construct somewhere, you must have that accessibility. And accessibility can only come when there is construction of roads, railways, and so forth and such. So
basically, infrastructural projects actually occur a lot. There's a correlation between matters of planning. Now, as we correct your sound, let me rope in Mr. Kasuku. We handled, or rather, we left it up at the issue of
are these infrastructural projects
priority?
Because when you look at it, the cost, the high cost of living, we are dealing with COVID-19 and such. A majority would say these infrastructural projects, please, not now, later, from where you sit.
Number one, I would like to state that some of the some of what we can call a discomfort, or what you can call the impatience in the economy, in which people are asking whether these are priorities, is actually, I would call it an illusionary impatience. We need this infrastructure. They are great priorities. I want to state it that if Kenya did not construct Jomo Kenyatta International Airport to the standard of what it is today in the 1970s, we could not be really counting ourselves as a good competitor in the region and in the continent, mm-hmm. and being a hub. We've been claiming, we've claimed the title of being a regional hub when we talk about key infrastructure investments that serve the region, not just Kenya alone. You talk about the port, you talk about the airport, you talk about the highways, corridors, you know. And these investments therefore have to be done. If we don't do them now, they'll be much, much costlier in the future. And even investments that we are undertaking today that ought to have been built before, they were much cheaper before. And when you hear some people saying that, you know, if the SGR was built, let's say by the year 2012, it was supposed to be cheaper. When you build it later, it gets costlier. When the expressway was supposed to have been built by the year 2012, you build it now, the investor, uses more resources beyond, because costs change, cost of materials change, cost of labor changes, and many other transactions that go with the development of infrastructure also change.
So changing what I would times, like to say, changing costs.
Changing times, changing costs, and you know, everything changes. Mm-hmm. And what I want to say is that the current global challenges that we are facing, like the COVID and the like, are not the only challenges that we'll ever face in this economy. There'll be more to come. So one particular challenge should not make us to feel like we should now crumble. We should now stop everything, and we should now just go on our knees and say, let's just eat, or let us get something to eat, and then the economy will recover. The economy cannot recover with food on the table alone, but it requires the backbone, it requires the structure, it requires the muscles, it requires the bones, like a human body, for it
and
to perform.
And that is infrastructure.
And that is infrastructure. Okay. If you don't have infrastructure, I can assure you, you'll cry more. When you hear farmers cannot be able to get their goods, produce to the market, when you hear that raw materials from farms cannot reach factories, when you hear that produced goods cannot reach consumers, then you know it is infrastructure that is lacking.
Infrastructure is a bomb. Let's talk about investment. Let's rope you in. He's speaking about the challenges that from where you sit within the value chain you go through. Yeah. One of the issues is land acquisition.
Sure.
What is your take on that, Mburu?
Yeah, thank you very much. And for sure, land matters are very pertinent to many people's heart. And actually, it is something that even when we are talking of the infrastructure, is something we as people have made it actually almost impossible for the infrastructure to be there, because you hear a road is passing by and people want to be compensated, and the land price go high, so very high. Then you find a road has been constructed and a land that was very cheap because there was no infrastructure, all of a sudden has skyrocketed in price and becomes unaffordable. And these are some of the things that are also, we have our development partners who are willing to assist, and the government is also, I believe, has the willpower, and there's that environment. But we as a people, we also need to change, to stop looking at shortcuts. You want to get easy money. You had a piece of land that had this value. Once a bypass is passed by the government there, all of a sudden the land becomes untouchable. So you find that, for example, if it's a developer, like as Mizizi Africa Homes Limited, you are looking at that land maybe to come and do affordable housing for people, and maybe we had an idea that there is a bypass that is going to pass there, so we feel this is a good place to develop. But now Once the road has passed by, you find that now the cost of land becomes untouchable, and by extension you find it becomes impossible for us, like as a developer, to come up with that affordable house. So what happens, the cost is passed on to the consumer. Yeah.
So from the private sector point of view then, are we having conversations, especially where in real estate is concerned, private sector engagement with government, so that you know prior, you know, investments, where they're going and how then this will affect, because we already know that those people who prospect, you know, expecting that these projects are coming this way. Stakeholder engagement with government, have they been bearing fruits?
Sure. Yeah, thank you very much. For sure, there has been that lack of information, and the dissemination of this information is very crucial. You find that some of those areas whereby somebody has that parcel of land, it is actually, they are not the original owners. It is somebody who had prior information, and this prior information was not shared to the public or to the stakeholders. And the few people who had the information, they held the information, they went, purchased the land, they knew in 2-3 years this land is going to pass there. So you actually find that even the people who are benefiting are not the original owners of that parcel of land. It is somebody who came and bought at a throwaway price, but because they knew there was going to be a development, they hiked the price very high. So the dissemination of information to the stakeholders, to developers, it is high time we agree that we all need to grow as a country, and we need to get rid of these bad behaviors, because basically that is a corruption. You have information which is not being shared by other people. We share the information, and if you had that information and you want to benefit out of the people who are ignorant, that should be discouraged, because that is encouraging corruption, and that is where we are going wrong as a country.
Okay. Mm. Mr. Kasuku, as we come to a close of this conversation, from where you sit, you know, advising government on matters of infrastructure and such, we have seen the land question, the land acquisition is a thorny issue, not for just private developers, but also for governments. And we've seen government has now opted to take some of these projects to its own government land. Is it something, is this a strategy that government is going to be taking on for years to come, that we have these projects, not necessarily where we would have wanted them because of the land question, but because we can, this is our land. Is this something that we're going to be seeing more of in the future?
Definitely, the issue of land for infrastructure, issue of land for government investments, is always something that is you know, of great concern. Number one, the society has become speculative and transactional to an extent that particular kind of behavior is actually affecting progress. And as such, what we therefore need to do as a society is to base our developments on appropriate planning. When we undertake proper planning of the investments that we need to undertake, then we end up making sure that if it is land that is required, then we set that land aside in readiness for that investment. If we need to expand a highway, we ought to have planned for it much earlier, so that we don't start moving people for us to expand a highway or for us to build a new highway. We ought to have paid for it much earlier. Like most of the infrastructure that you see today, particularly if you talk about the highway that comes from Mombasa going all the way to the borders, if you talk about the roads that you call bypasses in Nairobi, the railway leaves were actually acquired in the early 1970s, 71, 72 there. And having acquired them that much earlier has actually enabled us now to have the spaces we need for this investment. The only thing that has happened is that sometimes you find encroachers actually taking advantage of these spaces. When people see vacant land, even if it is for future infrastructure, they think it is vacant land, and then they start doing something on it.
But then they will argue that it was not branded as government land, so
yes,
everybody is looking somewhere.
That is now the equation that we need to resolve. We need actually to gazette all way leaves for infrastructure and all government development activities. They need to be gazetted, they need to be titled, and they need to have appropriate ownership or tenure documents. so that people do not come to make claims on them. So what I'm saying in short, we need to secure land much earlier using planning mechanisms, using planning strategies, using planning, development planning, policies, so that we don't come back to start even to buy government land that was already acquired, or land that was already earmarked is again being bought later on at a much higher cost. So we need to put planning way ahead of everything that we do.
Very well said. If you have been watching Good Morning Kenya, that conversation was about, you know, infrastructural investments going forward. And are they priority, given that Wanjiku has been decrying the high cost of living and saying some of these mega projects that we are witnessing are not priority? The two gentlemen with me in studio has been Sylvester Kasuku, who is currently the advisor, infrastructure advisor of government, and the immediate former CEO of the Lapset project there. And join also with him, or alongside him, is Dr. George Mboro, who is the CEO of Mzizi Africa. And what they have said is that we need to keep the focus, and that infrastructure is a backbone of not only the economy but also just life as we know it. So if you have been asking that question about whether it is priority that we continue with is this infrastructural developments that you're seeing, well, it seems that they are not going anywhere, because we're not only making this inroads in as far as development is concerned for our current generation, but also for generations to come. I'm Regina Manyera. Keep watching KBC Channel 1. Good Morning Kenya.
Well, such a candid conversation there, and we still have plenty more even after this. But before we embark on that, how about we quickly look at how the roads are looking like for our last traffic link? This has been our focus today. This is just the outer ring road, and remember that today we are trying to keenly focus on that latest report by NTSA that dubbed outer ring road as one of those roads here in Nairobi that records the highest number of death cases, even after that 13-kilometer stretch was expanded. And in addition to that, the 11 footbridges installed at various places. So just quickly, why I said I will explain to you a bit of that. This is actually why. So those footbridges that were installed were supposed to necessitate this, the crossing over of pedestrians from one side of the road to the other side. And also part of that was just reducing the traffic flow. But because of the encroachment of traders on most of these footbridges, as how most pedestrians are saying, this has resulted to a good number of them breaking some of these rails just to be able to cross over from one side to the other. And this is why Outer Ring Road, so far, out of the 439 deaths recorded between January 1st and October 31st, this particular road only has recorded 37 of those cases, followed by Thika Superhighway, which has recorded 34 of those death cases. And again, this is also why the bus rapid transit system, which is slowly taking shape along Thika Superhighway, was actually the first road in the country to undergo that BRT. This is just all in a bit to try and reduce traffic flow, as well as reduce on the number of accidents recorded on most of these roads, major roads as well as major highways. So this morning we're just trying to keenly focus on that. Even as we check the traffic flow along this specific route, we clearly know that at least as of now, some few, like two or three footbridges, are still remaining in terms of installation. But when it comes to the traffic flow, this is how it is looking like, especially on that area as you leave sections of Mombasa Road coming through Outer Ring via areas of Donholm, Manyanja Road. This is how the section is looking like. Not that bad, regardless of the fact that we know that there have been rains, you know, and we expect that to continue even for the next few days. So ultimately, that is expected to lead to heavy kind of traffic on most of these major roads, especially here in the city. But this is how it is looking like this morning. Not that bad, given the fact that it's also one of those busy roads, and that is also part of what resulted to that expansion, or better still, construction process that began in 2016 after commissioning by the president in 2015. So again, back the traffic flow, at least on the other side, as you leave areas of Juja Road, Thika Superhighway, Manyanja, Jogo, coming through Outer Ring as you head over to areas of Feather, Mombasa Road, at least on that particular section, or better still on that lane, this is how it is looking like, moving at a very, very swift pace. So it means that at least if you're having your activities, businesses, perhaps on those areas that I've just mentioned, then clearly this is the best time for you to perhaps leave your houses, or if at all you're on the roads, then again, it's still a good time for you, because right now moving at a very swift pace, no traffic at all. However, if you're going to the city center, still on that same section, that is how it is looking like. Heavy kind of traffic, not moving, at a standstill on some areas, actually on major parts along this particular section, moving at a very, very slow pace. But just like what you would spot on roads such as Ngong Road, most of those major roads where traffic police are usually stationed up in Ali to see how best they can control traffic, the same is also witnessed on this particular stretch. Again, one of those roads that also benefited from a bit of that reconstruction that was also happening on some of those slip roads. This is again one of them. That is Feather Road. So clearly a lot has taken place on this route. This is Outer Ring Road, the major road itself, as well as some of those slip roads and minor roads that get to branch off from this particular major road. Coming back again to the traffic flow, this is how it's looking like. Still nothing is changing. Heavy kind of traffic there. Perhaps you might quickly look at some alternative routes just right now, especially if you are coming to the city center. And again, just before I get to do that, remember that as of now, still Jogo Road serves as an alternative route for those going to areas of Lusaka. This is because of that ongoing construction around that particular stretch. So again, that is also part of why we are seeing that heavy kind of traffic there on that section, or on that road that gets to branch off from Outer Ring Road. So this has been our focus today. Again, just tracking that construction process, at least, and trying to understand that latest report by NTSA. At 23 minutes past 9, that is what it's looking like in terms of traffic on our road of focus this morning, which is Outer Ring Road.
Welcome back. We continue with the program. Thank you so much for staying with us this far. We now move on to our health segment, and today we're going to be focusing on sexual and reproductive health, given we are marking the 16 days of activism, which is all about the fight against gender-based violence perpetrated against women, more so, and also in line with what we will be marking tomorrow with the World AIDS Day. And with us in studio to help with this conversation, we have the pleasure of having one Rachel Mukami, who is a sexual and reproductive activist. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
I am very well. Thank you so much for making time to be with us today.
Thank you too.
All right. So maybe we could start with getting to know a bit about what you do in your line with activism around sexual and reproductive health. Where did that start from?
Okay. So like the way you said, my name is Rachel Mukali, not Mukali.
Oh, Mukali. Apologies, apologies, apologies.
Yeah. So I'm a Pan-African feminist, activist, and community organizer. From Mothering for More Settlement, and I convene a social movement called Coalition for Grassroots Human Rights Defenders, where we focus a lot on ending violence against women, human rights in general, and also around sexual and reproductive health and rights.
Yes.
And when I say sexual and reproductive health and rights, it's also because the Constitution of Kenya also guarantees us that we have a right when it comes to sexual reproductive health and rights. That's also like accessing contraceptive, family planning, and also information, and not forgetting also things to do with sexual transmitted diseases. And I like the way you have also like blend being 16 days of activism and the kind of challenges also women have gone through even during the pandemic, accessing, and youth like myself accessing sexual reproductive health and services, but also tomorrow being World AIDS Day, and also quoting from Nigani campaign, which is about also caring about ourselves, like how accessible also, let's say, condom in our public spaces, and how is the government providing in terms, as much as it's our right, but also how is our responsibility in terms of ensuring also we are holding the leaders into account to ensure that we have like condom and contraceptive to ensure that we don't lose also like a lot of youthful population also when it comes to now even the infection of HIV rate.
All right. Yeah. And that actually brings me to now this components of sexual and reproductive health that we are talking about. Mm. Let's narrow them down. And I'd like for us to start with the aspect about adolescent health, you know. Mm. And I'd like for you to just base from within your area, the community-based organization that you run, when it comes to adolescent health, understanding the reproductive systems straight from the school to the home setup, how do they complement each other to just ensure that this adolescent understands what reproductive health and sexual health is all about?
And I think also being a youthful person and going through this 844 system, I think there's a big gap in terms of how we do the education around sexual reproductive health and rights. Mm-hmm. And I think it's in class six when the topic comes. And it's usually mostly about reproduction, like these are the body works and about
these
pregnancy,
body parts,
body parts, but not into details. Into details like how does our body functions. Mm-hmm. For example, if you're having sex, what are the consequences? Most of the time, it'll be like you'll get pregnant, but you don't look diseases. We don't look also, yes, if you get pregnant. Mm-hmm. A lot of the time, even this, the other thing people need to be talking and looking up to read, it comes to the pregnancy. And that's why you'll see there's a lot of quacks also that are able to do unsafe abortion that also make the life of, like, we lose also like a lot of young women and girls through that, which shouldn't be the case. Mm-hmm. But in reality, is that we have to dig it deeper and deeper in terms of ensuring the information is being given the right of information without saying, you see, this is the problem. Like, we want to bury our heads in the sand and assuming people, youthful or adolescent, they're not having sex, they're having sex. But what is the kind of information you're giving them in terms of, yes, if there's condoms, yeah, they are. Can you use it? But we are not telling them, go and use it. But at least they know there's information. Because if you can look also like, even like during the pandemic, the number of girls that also have been violated by also men, it's also like you find there's not accountability in terms of also the guys, but at the same time accountability in terms of the information that was there in the public. So you find as adolescent girl or adolescent boys, you'll go finding information to your peers, which most of the time it's not accurate. Mm-hmm. Because the system that is supposed to teach you is not teaching you and giving you the information that is well needed.
It's a bit misguided.
Yeah.
And that brings me to now the next aspect, and this is all about contraception, and it has been a subject of such argument, a lot of back and forth, yes here, no there, maybe here. When it comes to allowing information and access to these contraceptives, from where you stand, from what you have seen interacting with the different people in the different spaces that you have, what is the general feel about contraceptives, and more so where the younger population is involved, and in this particular case, the adolescents?
I think it's very clear and important to have the conversation around contraceptive, not family planning. There's a difference. The difference, like for family planning, is where already you have had kids, you want to plan, but contraceptive is where a point I want to prevent pregnancy occurring. Mm-hmm. And the majority of my youthful population, which is 75% of in the country, is that we want the information or we know the information, but the service provider in our public hospitals are not friendly to younger population or to youthful population. So you'll find as a young woman who you haven't had kids or children, if you're going to a public hospital and tell them I want to access contraceptive, there's that demonization. I've experienced that as much as an activist I am in our public hospital. So you find it becomes a barrier for more young people. Now they'll want to go to a private hospital to seek the service, which shouldn't be the case, because already the constitution gives us that right that health should be, it's a human rights issue, which also reproductive and health services fall under that. But I like the work also that has been done by the from Nigani and also the Sexual Reproductive Health and Right Network, where they're trying to link communities with service provider, and these are youthful also people on how to access contraceptive. And now when you're asking that, it reminds me on a conversation and a workshop that I'm attending at the moment, organized by Athena Initiative, where it's bringing a lot of young people, young women from different backgrounds, to try and understand these are the gaps, this is the reality, and the girls are asking us, how do we disseminate this information to a point that they're able to have the right information and the education, so that they're able to make like decision that are not affecting their lives, but decisions that are also improving their lives. Yeah.
All right. And that in also comes the question about age and what information is appropriate for what age. How should we go about teaching our children about their sexual and their reproductive health and rights in a way that their age accommodates that and they're able to understand and comprehend?
I think it's important, but at the same time, you're looking also in terms of the age. It's not like black and white, it's a gray area, to a point that there's consent, because you know, as much as you're under 18, you're under your parents or guardian
yeah.
like in terms of the responsibility. But at the same time also, would we want to deny the information to the same kids and then it comes with a bigger consequence, or would we want to find a way on how we are telling them the reality? Like for example, when you start your period, most of the time, even when I'm starting my period, people will be quick and saying, Don't play with boys, you'll get pregnant. But you're not telling them, don't sleep with boys, you see. So it's very important like to ensure like how do we give the information and what are the modalities that we give information. Like in the communities we work with, even the kids we work with, we're like very clear. Yes, I know there are those who will say we should not give to this level, but it's important just to say, if you're sleeping with a boy or a girl, these are the consequences. You'll either get pregnant or you'll either get STIs or STDs. At least you have the information. But the way things are evolving, the way the youthful population is evolving, and the way the adolescent population is evolving, if you are not giving them the right information, they'll go to the internet.
And that comes in the role of the parents, because we are living in a time where parents have left this responsibility to the teacher to teach the children about your sexual reproductive system, and then the teacher also expects the parent to complement this conversation back home. How then do we bring the efforts from both the teacher's side and the parent's side to complement each other, all in an effort to benefit this child?
For me, if you ask me, it needs to be a collaborative work, both from the parent's side and from the teacher's side. It should not be left to the parents and to the teacher, because the moment you do that is the moment now we get these consequences nowadays we are having. Like we have seen cases, like even during COVID, where we had cases, even the media was highlighting, where there were a group of also adolescent teenagers that had to go and drink and had sex. It was a whole discussion in the country, but for me it was like, one, as much as we are complaining, these are things that are happening. At least this one has come to the public, but at least they use protection. Because the reality, if we can't all of us have this discussion, people are having sex, kids are having sex, even amongst themselves. But we should not leave it to the teachers. It's any space, if you ask me, even now we are heading, it's any space that is being created, whether by the public or private space, even in churches. These are the conversation we need to start having, instead of demonizing and telling people you're fornicating. But the reality is they're having sex.
All right.
Give them the right information to protect themselves.
So clearly there's a challenge when it comes to empowering our children with this information. And let's talk a bit about, you know, these points of information. How available should they be made to these kids to enable them make better decisions? Because at the end of the day, they are still engaging in whatever they're engaging in, but with the absence of knowledge that they need. Which points do you feel are effective when it comes to the dissemination of this information? You know, from what you've mentioned, you know, we have church leaders, we have hospitals, we have parents, teachers. From what you have experienced,
You see on the website of Omnigania, there's a lot of information, and maybe I'll urge the public to look at it about access to this information and also to service provider and contraceptive. But at the same time, let's look, for example, here in the media, can we have programs that we're able to talk about these issues? Like the way during the COVID, we'll talk about washing your hands. Let's have a clear conversation around sex sexuality and about also sexual reproductive health and rights into detail, not just these are your body parts, these are the function, but at the same time, like trying to see what are the other ways. Like for example, I've seen communities, most of people have become creative, even the activism part, where people are coming with skits that people are performing, and then people are reacting with comments and things that are able to push in terms of knowledge, understanding. Because not everybody will go and read at the book, and not everybody in Kenya has that privilege of also internet. But the point of ensuring that even the local organization and local initiative, even the governments, like the local hospitals, how effective are they? Like now tomorrow is World AIDS Day. Are we having this discussion? Are we linking while it's day with sexual reproductive health and rights, because they are connected. Because mm-hmm. it's about safer sex, it's about condom usage, it's about knowing your status. But if we can link, because also it's personal, and that's why like it comes from a point of also self-care, like mm-hmm. I have to jali myself. Lazima nijijali to a point I'm able to know it about my body, not someone else's body.
Yeah.
And I think we need to personalize that and politicize that it's about you from a personal perspective. And at the same time, ensuring when people also are able here in public to talk about it, you don't demonize them.
All right.
Because I think in Kenya we do that. We are good in demonizing people when it comes to sexual reproductive health and rights. Mm-hmm. We are like, oh, so you think that information is too much, but we are doing that.
And speaking of demonizing, we're also living in a time where our young population are engaging in transactional sex just because of the poverty levels,
exactly.
You know, consequently yeah. leading to a myriad of unexpected consequences for them.
Yeah.
How can we help alleviate this problem, poverty being a driving factor when it comes to irresponsible sexual behavior?
And I think it's key and it's important understanding that there's poverty, and most of the time, even when we're talking about transactional sex, like here also we need to look at it in terms of patriarchal system mm-hmm. and structure that works against women and girls. Like here there's someone who has money and he thinks the only way to take advantage of a girl is giving them the money and sleeping with them.
Mm-hmm.
So this also should be part of also now looking in terms of violence. It's a part of violence mm-hmm. that also during these 16 days of activism you're talking about. And for me, it's also it's clear that 16 days of activism should not be only from 25th to 10, but it should be like on our daily level, these are the things that are happening, but are we calling it out?
Yes.
How is the government structure like supportive and system such that when these cases or we find someone has taken advantage of a younger girl, mm-hmm. we're able to hold them into account? So it's very important and key, and knowing it's violence. We can't remove that, yes, it's transactional, without bringing the word that it's violence and holding people into account and the perpetrators into account because of taking advantage of the small girls because of their poverty level.
All right.
Yeah.
Now, as we bring the conversation to a close, just your call to action message to everyone who's watching or listening to us today. Number one, in line with when it comes to sexual and reproductive health, understanding it starts with you as yeah. an individual before it flows to the next person. Number two, looking at the 16 days of activism when it comes to ending gender-based violence against women. And number three, World AIDS Day tomorrow, all about, you know, understanding the status of HIV and AIDS and sexually transmitted diseases along with that.
Yeah. So I think for me, it's one, government need to invest more money mm-hmm. on sexual reproductive health and rights. Research is there. And also in their shelves, so more money, more awareness. At the same time, also like normalizing the discussion around sexual reproductive health and rights, beyond just condom, to other means and other options. Because I think most of the time, also there are no options. Like you go to a hospital, a doctor hasn't done the diagnosis, like which method suits you.
Mm.
But it's important just to normalize that in terms of also the facility being friendly to young people. At the same time, we need to encourage safer sex, especially to our youthful population, in terms of, it's not bad, like go and access it and go and ask to that hospital, but also holding the government accountable in terms of ensuring that these facilities are available to their young people. These facilities are available to the public, to the citizens, to be able to access the services. But at the same time, it's our collective work to end violence against women and girls.
Yes.
It's not the responsibility of women. It's the collective work of citizens, not women.
Every individual.
I have to be everyone, yeah. And then being tomorrow's World AIDS Day also, let's stand in solidarity with our brothers, our sisters, our people, in terms of also ensuring that we're able to support them and not discriminate them.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, ensuring that also we're able to center in the conversation also accessibility of also the medication, because we realize even during COVID it was mm-hmm. hard to get the medication
yes,
for ARVs.
Yes.
So it's really important to ensure that when they're not getting that medication, is also violence. So we need to move from a point of just saying it's here, but to a point of implementing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Thank you so much for that. This has all been about sexual and reproductive health, and particularly focusing on the younger population, given they are the majority of those in our world. But for now, we want to end it at that particular point. Remember, we are still marking the 16 days of activism, which began on the 25th of November and will be running up until the 10th of December. We are going to be having consequent discussions to build up on that. And of course, tomorrow being a World AIDS Day, we will be having a conversation with one of the representatives from the National AIDS Control Council. For now, we want to wish you a lovely day. We have been speaking with Rachel Mwikali, who is a sexual and a reproductive health activist. Thank you so much once again.
Thank you too.
All right.
It was a really nice conversation.
Fantastic. For now, it is goodbye. See you tomorrow.
My daughter here will be representing me, and that means that she will be leading this project.
Out of here right now, or I will throw you out myself.
No.
I hope those two kill each other.
Please.
You really want us to make one last effort to be a family? You need to explain to me what you're talking about.
Might know the truth, and he might know that I'm here to get my revenge on Victoriano because of what he did to my father.
The Amazons.
Hii ni mitika sileo makala kutoka BBC yaliyomo. Rais Yoweri Museveni wa Uganda kamilisha ziara ya siku tatu nchini Tanzania. Kipi ya kati ya mahusiano ya Tanzania na Uganda tunakupasha. Baada ya Afrika Kusini pamoja na wataalamu wa kisayansi wakemea hatua zilizochukuliwa na baadhi ya mataifa duniani kufunga anga na mipaka yake kwa nchi saba kutoka kusini mwa Afrika kutokana na ujio wa aina mpya ya virusi vya corona. Kisha kampuni ya ndege ya Uganda yaweka marufuku uzaaji wa panzi maarufu nsenene ndani ya ndege. Mbashara kutoka Nairobi, Kenya, twende kazi. Karibu katika makala inayoangazia habari za biashara zinazokuhusu, uchambuzi wa kina na mahojiano. Ni Telines Moshigadi. Tuanze. Rais wa Uganda Yoweri Museveni anatarajiwa kukamilisha ziara yake ya siku tatu nchini Tanzania hii leo. Katika ziara hiyo, Museveni tayari amezuru bandari ya Dar es Salaam, reli mpya SGR, na pia kushiriki katika kongamano la wafanyabiashara wa Tanzania na Uganda. Katika mazungumzo na mwenyeji wake Rais Samia Suluhu Hassan, viongozi hao waligusia ujenzi wa bomba la mafuta la kilomita 1443 ambalo litasafirisha mafuta ghafi kutoka ufuoni mwa ziwa Albert nchini Uganda hadi bandari ya Tanga nchini Tanzania. Takriban 80% ya bomba hilo litakuwa nchini Tanzania. Nchi hizo mbili zinatumai kwamba bomba hilo litaziongezea kipato na pia kutoa takriban nafasi 10,000 za ajira. Na mko sasa naungana naye mwanahabari wa BBC Fama Abubakar aliyekambi Dodoma. Famao, karibu katika mitikasi leo. Labda ziara hii ya Rais Museveni nchini Tanzania imekuwa na umuhimu gani?
Na asante sana, tukumbuke kwamba hii ni ziara ya Rais Museveni kutoka Uganda. Uganda ni nchi jirani na Tanzania, na vile vile ni nchi ambayo ina mafungamano ya karibu sana kisiasa, kiuchumi na vile vile kibiashara. Lakini tukumbuke hapa katikati vile vile kuna mradi mkubwa sana ambao unaendelea kati ya Tanzania na Uganda, nao ni ujenzi wa bomba la mafuta ghafi kutoka kule Uganda na kuja hapa nchini Tanzania. Kwa maana hiyo kikubwa ilikuwa ni suala la kuleta ushirikiano zaidi na vile vile kukutanisha wafanya biashara kutoka nchi mbili hizi, ili kuweza kuangalia ni fursa gani ambazo zinaweza kupatikana kutokana na mradi huu ambao una gharimu takriban dola bilioni za Kimarekani 4.1, na vile vile utasababisha kuleta ajira takriban kuanzia 10,000 mpaka 15,000 kwa raia wa nchi mbili hizi.
Famao, kipi ambacho wameweza kukubaliana marais hawa wawili kuhusiana na ujenzi huu wa bomba la mafuta ya reli, mafuta ya gas?
Kikubwa ilikuwa tayari makubaliano yamefanyika muda mrefu tayari, na nchi mbili hizi zishatiliana saini. Kwa maana hiyo, kilichopo sasa hivi ilikuwa ni ufuatiliaji tu wa karibu wa kuangalia utekelezaji wa mradi huu unakwenda vipi, na kama nilivyosema pale awali, kujaribu kuleta fursa kwa wafanyabiashara wa nchi mbili hizi, kuangalia sasa ni fursa gani ambazo zinaweza kupatikana kutokana na mradi huo.
Na katika miaka hivi nyuma kumekuwa na mvutano kibiashara kati ya Tanzania na Uganda. Viongozi hao labda wamegusia swala hilo?
Naam, bila shaka. Na Rais Samia Suluhu Hassan wa Tanzania ametilia mkazo sana kwamba hapo awali kulikuwa na mikwaruzano kidogo kati ya nchi jirani. Alitolea mfano kati ya nchi ya Tanzania na Kenya mathalan, na kusema kutokana na mazungumzo ambayo yamefanyika mikwaruzano hiyo imekwisha, na sasa anaangalia zaidi kati ya Uganda na Tanzania. Na akazungumzia vile vile swala la Uganda ambayo imetaka kuuza sukari nchini Tanzania, na hapo awali kukawa na sintofahamu kidogo, lakini amesema kwamba hivi sasa ruksa kabisa Tanzania itanunua sukari ya Uganda.
Shukran Famao. Kwa sasa tupe macho taarifa zingine za biashara kutoka barani Afrika na kimataifa. Kuanzia Jumanne wiki hii, raia nchini Zambia ambao hawajachanjwa dhidi ya COVID-19 watazuiliwa kuingia katika majengo ya serikali. Kadhalika itawahitaji watumishi wa umma kuonyesha udhibitisho wa chanjo ili waweze kupokelewa kazini, hatua hiyo itakayotekelezwa baada ya mashauriano na vyama vya wafanyakazi. Aidha, wageni wote watakaotoka katika nchi zilizoorodheshwa kwa hatari watakiwa kujitenga kwa siku 10 kwa gharama zao wenyewe. Alafu shirika la ndege la Uganda limepiga marufuku uzaji wa chakula aina ya panzi ndani ya ndege baada ya tukio lilotokea mwishoni mwa juma. Shirika hilo limesema uzaji wa kitoweo hicho kinachojulikana kama nsenene unakinzana na maadili ya shirika la taifa, na kwamba lina mipango ya kuongeza chakula hiki kwenye menyu yao ya wasafiri. Alafu serikali ya Burkina Faso inasema inaondoa marufuku ya huduma za intaneti iliyokuwa imewekwa kwa simu za mikono wiki moja baada ya kuweka marufuku hiyo kwa kile ilichosema ni sababu za kiusalama na ulinzi. Usitishaji huo umejiri huku kukiwa na hasira na maandamano makali dhidi ya kile waandamaji walisema ni serikali kutokuwa na uwezo kukomesha mashambulizi mabaya ya wanamgambo wa Kiislamu. Hii ni Mitikasi Leo kutoka BBC, tukaangazia hivi punde. Afrika Kusini na wataalamu wa kisayansi wakemea hatua za nchi mbalimbali kufunga anga na mipaka yake sababu ya kuchipuka upya kwa COVID-19. Ulimwengu umeingiwa na mchecheto wa kukabili virusi vipya vya korona vilivyo na asili yake Afrika Kusini, hasa baada ya kuonekana kasi yake ya kuenea. Kwa sasa virusi hivyo tayari vimerekodiwa katika nchi 13. Aidha, mawaziri wa afya wa mataifa iliyostawi zaidi kiuchumi ya G7 wanakutana Jumatatu kujadili mbinu za kupambana na virusi hivyo vipya. Kufikia sasa zaidi ya mataifa 34 yameweka marufuku ya usafiri kutoka nchi 7 zilizoko kusini mwa Afrika, huko nchi kutoka bara Asia zikiiga mfano. Rwanda imekuwa taifa la kwanza Afrika kuweka marufuku ya safari za ndege kutoka mataifa ya kusini mwa Afrika. Rais wa Afrika Kusini Cyril Ramaphosa alisema siku ya Jumapili alikosoa mzi wa baadhi ya nchi kupiga marufuku safari za ndege kutoka nchi za Afrika Kusini kwa kudai kwamba kikubwa kinachopaswa kuangaziwa zaidi ni usambazaji wa chanjo kwa usawa duniani kote na wala sio uwepo wa marufuku hayo. Tumsikize.
We are deeply disappointed by the decision of several.
Tumesikitishwa sana na uamuzi wa nchi kadhaa kupiga marufuku usafiri wa watu kutoka nchi zilizo kusini mwa Afrika, ikiwa ni pamoja na Afrika Kusini, kufuatia kugunduliwa kwa aina nyingine ya virusi vya corona Omicron. Hatua hiyo ni wazi haina msingi kabisa na inakiuka ahadi ambayo nchi nyingi zilizostawi kiuchumi za G20 ziliweka katika mkutano wa kila mwaka ulioandaliwa mjini Rome mwezi uliopita. Sasa vikwazo hivi havina uhalali kabisa na vinabagua dhidi ya nchi yetu na nchi zilizo kusini mwa Afrika. Marufuku ya kusafiri haitokani na sababu za kisayansi na havitakuwa na ufanisi wowote katika kuzuia kuenea kwa virusi hivi vipya. Kitu pekee ambacho katazo la kusafiri kitafanya ni kuharibu zaidi uchumi wa nchi zilizoathirika na kudhoofisha uwezo wa nchi hizi kufufua chumi zao kutokana na janga la corona.
Na mwengi humuita Sharo Minyato, jina ambalo linatokana na mitindo ya utembeaji na utumia ambao hunyata mithili ya kinyonga au mnyama simba.